On August 5th, 2012, after rocketing through space for more than 8 months, NASA's Curiosity rover began a 7-minute descent onto a crater on Mars. At the time of its landing, the one-ton SUV-sized rover was more than 150 million miles from Earth, which meant that it took 14 nail-biting minutes for the NASA team at Mission Control to learn the fate of its $2.5 billion rover.
Touchdown confirmed. We're safe on Mars.
The Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California, manages the Mars Science Laboratory mission, which is using Curiosity's suite of sophisticated scientific instruments to reveal tantalizing clues about the existence of ancient life on the red planet. Less than 2 months after arriving, Curiosity's high-definition cameras captured for the first time images of gravel from a stream bed, evidence that fresh water once flowed on Mars billions of years ago. In 2013, Curiosity's analysis of Martian rocks also revealed the presence of oxygen, water, carbon, and sulfides, ingredients necessary to support life. Curiosity has already driven more than 5 miles and continues to beam images and measurements, proving that this barren, frigid planet once had an environment where tiny organisms could have lived. But one thing Curiosity can't do is spot current signs of Martian life. Still, Curiosity's amazing discoveries would not have been possible without the advanced engineering behind the scientific instruments that power this high-tech search for extraterrestrial life.
Mars is really interesting for the search for life because it's a world which we know at one time had an Earth-like period. It had water, it had rivers, lakes, maybe even an ocean, and therefore we think it must have had a thick atmosphere.
Christopher McKay from NASA Ames Research Center in Mountain View, California, has spent more than 30 years looking for life on other worlds.
We know that rocks have come from Mars and landed on Earth. We assume that the reverse is also possible, and we know that these rocks could carry life. But I think a deeper and more important question is the possibility that there was life on Mars and it represents a separate origin of life, a second genesis.
Since the 1960s, dozens of increasingly sophisticated robotic spacecraft, including orbiters, landers, and rovers, have been launched from Earth toward Mars. The twin rovers Spirit and Opportunity landed on the surface of Mars in 2004. Natalie Cabrol of the SETI Institute in Mountain View was on the team that decided where to send them.
We went from Mars frozen in time, cold, on the lava plain to earlier Mars on the Columbia Hills, a time where climate was warmer and geological activity was a lot more diverse. And all of a sudden we discovered evidence of water, evidence for volcanic activity, interacting with water, explosive activity.
And now the Curiosity rover, the largest and most sophisticated science laboratory ever sent to Mars, is collecting more data about the planet than all preceding Mars missions.
You have microscopes and lasers to zap the dust from the surface so that you can look really at the composition of what you're looking at. You will be able to see mineralogy, composition, chemistry. To me, Curiosity, is this amazing Swiss Army knife rover of the Mars exploration, you know.
One of the tools in that Swiss Army knife is called Kemen. It was invented by astrogeologist David Blake from NASA Ames.
Yeah, we're in the right place, I think.
Yep.
A few years before Curiosity's launch, Blake and his colleague Tori Holler tested a terrestrial prototype of Kemen at Jasper Ridge in the eastern foothills of the Santa Cruz Mountains.
So we're going to do the processing of these rocks just like Curiosity would do it on Mars, but of course we don't have the real fancy hardware that's on Curiosity. We basically have hammers and things like that.
Kemen is able to identify the minerals in samples of powdered rock or soil through X-ray diffraction. Here, an X-ray beam is focused on a sample, and how the X-rays scatter can help reveal the sample's structure and composition.
Just put a little bit inside of that hole. I can see within 10 seconds that this is a serpentine rock.
It takes up to 10 hours for Kevin to do on Mars what Blake's prototype did in just a few minutes at Jasper Ridge. The data from the analysis of each sample goes to the rover's computer, then to an orbiting satellite, and then back to Earth, where Blake and his team analyze the results.
If we find rocks that are similar to what we saw in the field today, we would be able to say that there was water present there, that energy was present, created by those rocks, that could be used by a microbe for life.
As the nuclear-fueled rover transmits its stunning images and carefully collected data, the question remains, could life actually exist on the red planet? Cabrol looks for an answer to that question in some of the most extreme and inhospitable environments on Earth.
I have yet to find a place where I did not find life on Earth. In one of these most impossible places, you still find things. That tells you something, that sends you a message. Wherever life can be, it's gonna be.
In 2012, NASA announced Mars 2020, a new mission that will continue to dig for clues of past life and also gather data about habitability of the red planet, information that would be key to the success of future human expeditions to Mars.
I think there will certainly be human exploration of Mars. We'll go to the moon, we'll set up a base there, and then we'll go to Mars. The question is really just when, and will I be around to see it?
Given all the problems we face on Earth, is the search for life on Mars worth all of the effort and expense?
It's just like asking Christopher Columbus, which most of the European kings and queens did at the time, what there is to go and explore. At some point, you have to take a leap of faith. But if you don't take that leap, you will never know.